We're going to need the help of robots and other forms of, I guess you could say, employment. We're going to be employing a lot of artificial things.
Today on AI News, we're taking a look into the future with the leading AI and robotics predictions for 2026 so that you can determine who will be the winners and who will be the losers.
We're going to have tremendous workforce availability. We're also going to have robots helping us. We're going to have a lot of robots helping us because we need it. And because we're going to town, we're building a lot between the AI and the auto plants. So we're going to need robots. We're going to have robots, but that's going to help us. We're going to have tremendous workforce. And in order to operate, you're always going to need people. You know, you could have robots, but you're going to have to get somebody to start those robots, and you're going to have to improve the robots. But we're going to have robotic factories plus manpower. So we're going to have enough. We're going to need the help of robots and other forms of, I guess you could say, employment. We're going to be employing a lot of artificial things. But the beauty is we're going to have more jobs than we've ever had. Just so you know, a number came out the other day. We have more jobs right now in the United States. More people are working right now in the United States than at any time in the history of our country. Think of that. Pretty amazing. So we'll have the help of, you know, mechanical help, if you want to call it that. But we'll have tremendous employment. They'll be paid a lot of money. They'll do better than they ever did.
And there will be other ways of us thinking about memory that haven't even been brought mainstream yet. That's going to be one of the three most important things, at least in the next year, for getting AI agents to work. The second is communication protocols. You know, we've talked a lot about MCP, and this idea that in order to have agents work together, they have to be able to talk together. Mm-hmm. You know, we both speak the same language, not only the same technical language of English, but a similar business language and a similar, you know, technical jargon that helps us communicate really fluently. AI agents are going to have something similar. And that actually reminds me a lot like the internet, where in the early days you had TCP/IP, that wasn't the finish line, that was the starting gun. Mm-hmm. And then the third is AI security. So now that you have agents that have memories and are communicating with each other, we're gonna have to figure out ways that they communicate very securely. Mm-hmm. And it's actually Jensen who said this in a previous conversation. I thought it was pretty awesome. He said, think about agents as not needing to have the same requirements of the physical world. But in the future, he pointed out, maybe you're gonna have 1,000 security agents around one cognitive intelligence agent. Mm-hmm. And so we have so much to solve in the security side of things. Those three areas, memory, communication, security, are all being solved real time and are gonna yield the agent economy.
You said the agent economy, I love that term. We call it digital workers, but there's gonna be some sort of niche market that's built up around new frameworks, new training types, just to support this economy, right? So it, like, just like we have an economy for humans, we're gonna have an economy for agents.
AI addresses the segment of the economy that IT has never addressed. Having AI that augments labor is going to help us grow.
The moment we have intelligence that's worthy of being paid for, and as soon as that flywheel goes, then everything else will take care of itself. And this is no different than the moment that humanoid robotics starts to do productive things and people are willing to pay for it, and it's a profitable endeavor, then you could scale up as large as you want to scale up. And so that's really the moment we're looking for. We're looking for that virtuous cycle where AI starts to generate productive tokens, profitable tokens. After that, the flywheel takes off. You're going to lose your jobs not to somebody, not to a robot. You're going to lose your jobs to somebody who uses a robot. You're going to lose your jobs to somebody who uses AI.
There are no useful humanoid robots at this point. There are sort of gimmicks, but there are no actually useful humanoid robots. And I think Tesla's going to make the first actually useful humanoid robots. And this will be quite a revolution. And I think something that everyone will want, because I always think of, like, who wouldn't want their own personal C-3PO R2-D2? Everyone would want one, right? And then there would be many in industry providing products and services. This is why I say that humanoid robots will be the biggest industry, or the biggest product ever. Bigger than cell phones or anything else, because everyone's gonna want one, and or maybe more than one, and there'll be many in industry. And we're finalizing the design of AI 5, which will be an immense jump from AI 4. By some metrics, the improvement in AI 5 will be 40 times better than AI 4. 40%, 40 times. And this is because we work so closely at a very fine-grained level.
But the big one that we're focused on is building an AI and a machine learning engineer to advance the llama development itself, right? Because, I mean, our bet is sort of that in the next year, probably, you know, I don't know, maybe half the development is going to be done by AI as opposed to people, and then that will just kind of increase from there. And I mean, I tend to think that like every engineer is effectively going to end up being more of like a tech lead in the future that has sort of their own little army of engineering agents that they work with.
I would say you're going to see them in the workforce over the coming year or two. And then we will only launch a product in the home, in the workforce, at scale, once we feel confident of the product.
Right.
We will not do it early. We will not teleoperate them in market. Like, we will not do any of this silly stuff. And I think that's maybe different from other groups maybe in the space, but we are trying to build like end-to-end autonomy with low human intervention rates in these, in this commercial end market. So once we're able to like really sell into your home, to Brad's home, we want to be really confident it's going to really work and it's going to be really safe.
There's so much ahead, you know, on the opportunity side. You know, I'm blown away by the ability to discover new drugs, you know, completely change how we treat diseases like cancer over time, et cetera. You know, the opportunity is there. You know, the creative power, which I talked about, which we're putting in everyone's hands. Like the next generation of kids, everyone can program and will to, if you think of something, you can create it. I don't think we have comprehended what that means, but that's going to be true. The part which the next phase of the shift, which is going to be really meaningful, is when this translates into the physical world through robotics. Right, so that aha moment of robotics, I think when it happens, that's going to be the next big thing we will all grapple with. Right, today they are all online and you're doing things with it, but you know, one hand, you know, today I think of Waymo as a robot, right? So we're running around, driving around a robot, but I'm talking more general purpose robot, and you know, and when AI creates that magical moment with robotics, I think that'll be a big platform shift as well.
Finally, the CEO of XPeng, China's version of Tesla, with their plans being to start mass production preparation for both hardware and software in April of 2026. And they expect their Iron model to be the smartest humanoid robot because of the use of 3 combined large language models. Anyways, like and subscribe, check out this video here, and thanks for watching. Bye.